Grand morning, grand morning, grand morning. It's 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time on this Tuesday, March the 17th of 2020. Hello, Lakeisha McKnight is here, your teacher slash facilitator here for the virtual Bible study. And so we're just getting started on Facebook and Spreaker and iHeartRadio and the LeadershipTKOStation.com's website. And so, again, welcome to everyone. We're gradually getting ourselves planted here, and I'm going to actually start a watch party this time. I know I didn't do it the last couple of times, so I'm going to go ahead and do one this time. All right. Here we go. So I'm going to find the group, and then I'm going to put in the description. Okay, here we go. So welcome for everyone in the United States. Welcome to everyone abroad. You're more than welcome to tune in as well. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So welcome for those, once again, that's on my timeline on Facebook. Welcome and good morning to those inside of Facebook groups that I'm going live in, because sometimes I go live in several groups at one time. And that's only because I would love to reach more people and help other people and inspire other people. That is the reason for going live in the groups with the virtual Bible study. But this study is just for those who do want to jumpstart their day with the Lord. If you really want to understand how to win from the inside out, this is the virtual Bible study for you. Now, we encourage everybody to keep having your one-on-one time with God. Keep, you know, as long as you're able, you know, to be able to meet with others in person. I know they have a lot of restrictions going on and having people in their homes. So you want that extra dose of the Word of God. And so that's the reason why we have the virtual Bible study. So you're more than welcome to tune in, everyone. And I will tell you that we try to do this every single morning around 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, except on Sundays. Okay, except on Sundays. We may begin to make an exception and do it on Sunday. For this purpose only, because of all that's going on, we shall see. All right. Because I know that many people need hope. They need inspiration during this season. And we know that, you know, the best way to reach people as of right now is through social media and online. All right. So there are a couple of ways to engage during this virtual Bible study. So number one, like or love the stream if you know that the Word of God can change lives, including your life. Okay, hit that love button, hit the like button. Number two, we do have the comments feature. So if you'd like to share your thoughts, if you have questions that you would like to ask, go ahead and post them in the comments area as well. And then lastly, we do have the share feature. So you're able to share this on your timeline. You're able to conduct a watch party. You're able to just do whatever it is that you feel led to doing as far as sharing this with people directly. Because you never know what a person is going through, what they're facing in this season, this difficult time that we're living in presently. And so everyone can use an extra dose of inspiration. And so you're more than welcome to hang around, listen in, get your physical Bible before we even dive into the Word. Okay? So let me just share with you how everything works here. Not much, you know, not anything too complex, okay? But while we're on the platform, what normally happens is I go over these guidelines, okay, and then we're going to pray. We need to make sure that our hearts and our minds are prepared to receive the Word of God. After prayer, we will begin with reading. So we're going to be taking a look today at John chapter 4, verses 1 through 26. John chapter 4, verses 1 through 26 is where we're going to be studying today, okay? So you can take note of that. After we do read the scripture, we're definitely going to assess what encouraged John to include these verses in his gospel account. Like what motivated him to include these verses? Because you have to understand the Word in context, right? And then after we do that, we're definitely going to take a look at how do we apply this to our lives? We have to make the Word practical, especially with where we are today, you know, and how do we make this work for us today? In modern day. And of course, you know, keeping it in perspective based on when it was written. Okay, you got to do that. You don't want to take word of out of context and try to make it apply, right? If it doesn't apply at all because of when it was written. Okay, so we're going to do that. We'll summarize what we've read, and then we're going to pray so that we can be dismissed. So that's the normal flow for the virtual Bible study. And like I said, people come in and they listen live and they catch the replay as well. So you may see people coming in and out based on where you are, whether it's the group or on my timeline or on the podcast platform. So there are some people who are not even on Facebook. Okay, they're not even on Facebook and they're listening in to the stream right now. So you're not alone. There are thousands of people who do tune in. A good majority of them listen in by way of podcast from other countries. All right, so let's go ahead. We're going to pray right now so we can begin. So Father in heaven, Lord, we say thank you so very much for this day. This is the day, Father, that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. God, we thank you so much for the rest that you've given us last night and the ability to open up our eyes to see today. We thank you for the use of all of our senses, being able to touch, to smell, to taste. Father God, we thank you so much, Lord, for allowing us to be in our right minds. The mindset of being able to get up and to give you thanks and to give you the glory for who you are. Because you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You're the great I Am. And there's no one like you. There's no one before you. You are God and you are God alone. And so, Father, we just give you the honor. We give you the honor because you're worthy of it and you deserve it all. And so, God, in this moment, we're praying and asking, Father, that you would forgive us of all sin. Cleanse our hearts, Father. Cleanse our minds of all unrighteousness. Guide us and direct us by your Spirit, Lord. Help us, Father God, that we will walk in obedience to your direction, to your voice. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray that as we're opening up the word, that you will make it plain for us, that you would bless us with wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, God. May we not only be readers of the word, but help us to be doers of the word. Help us to be able to rightly divide the word of truth and give us the boldness and the courage to be able to share this with other people in our homes and in our local communities and anywhere that you send us. Give us boldness to share the word of God. And so, God, we thank you, we love you, and we ask all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and amen. All right. So once again, grand morning. Welcome aboard, everyone, to the virtual Bible study. So we're in John chapter 4. We're in John chapter 4. That's where we are. We're going to start at verse number 1. And so let's go ahead and get started. Verse number 1. It says, therefore, when the Lord knew that the Pharisees had heard that Jesus made and baptized more disciples than John, though Jesus himself did not baptize but his disciples, he left Judea and departed again to Galilee. But he needed to go through Samaria. So he came to a city of Samaria which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now, Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman of Samaria said to him, "How is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered and said to her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered and said to her, "Whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water that I may thirst, that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw." Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered and said, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You have said well," or "well said. I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you now have is not your husband. In that you spoke truly." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, and you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." Amen, amen, and amen. So we just read John chapter 4, verses 1 through 26. So we're going to take a closer look. Let's take a closer look at that which we've read and break it down just a bit. Okay, just a bit. Now, these verses that we read this morning, I'll tell you this in summary. It's really the story of a Samaritan woman. It really does reinforce, you know, John's main theme here with this gospel account. Okay, that Jesus is the Messiah and Son of God. Okay, see, the thrust of these verses is not so much really her conversion, but that Jesus is Messiah. Now, while her conversion, it's clearly implied here. You see, the apostle's focus centers on Jesus' declaration foretold in the scripture. Okay? Important also is the fact that this chapter really demonstrates really Jesus's love and his understanding of people. Okay, that's the focus, his understanding of people. His love for mankind involved no boundaries at all, because he was loving and compassionately reaching out to a woman who was a social outcast because she was a Samaritan. Okay? See, it's what's really different from the limitations of human love, you know, is that Christ, he actually exhibits the character of divine love that is indiscriminate and really all-encompassing as well. And that's what makes him completely, of course, different from us and how we love. Okay? And so notice all of what was going on. So he had left, you see in verse number three, you know, Jesus had left Judea and departed again to Galilee. Okay, so John the Baptist and Jesus had scrutiny focused on them because of their distinctive message regarding repentance and the kingdom. And so most likely Jesus wanted to avoid any possible trouble with John's disciples, because remember that was going on in the previous chapter. So he wanted to avoid possible trouble with John's disciples, who were troubled with his growing popularity. Okay, he was growing in popularity. And so the Pharisees were also focusing on his growing influence as well. So look at verse 4 where it says, "But he needed to go through Samaria." That was a huge point right there. He needed to go through Samaria. See, there are several roads that led from Judea to Galilee. Okay. And so he chose a specific road, a road that some people say is less traveled. All right. And so understand something. Jesus had an appointment, right, with divine destiny in really meeting the Samaritan woman to whom he would reveal his messiahship. Okay. Revealing his messiahship. Now understand something about Samaria. And this is what we really need to understand. Okay. Because you probably like, well, what makes Samaria a problem or so much of an issue that even Jews didn't want to really interact with them? You see, Samaria, when the nation of Israel split, they actually split politically, you know, after Solomon ended his rule. Okay, there was a king named King Omri, right? A king named King Omri. And so there's a lot of dissension, a lot of concerns that was going on. And so because of that, it really left a huge issue. There was a huge issue that really broke out, okay, with different tribes. See, while Assyria led most of the populace of the 10 northern tribes away, it really left a specific population of Jews in the northern Samaritan region, okay, and transported many non-Jews into Samaria. Now, these groups intermingled to form a mixed race through intermarriage. Now, eventually, tension developed between the Jews who returned from captivity and the Samaritans. Now, the Samaritans withdrew from the worship of Yahweh at Jerusalem and established their worship in Samaria. Now, Samaritans regarded only the Pentateuch as authoritative. The Pentateuch. Now, anybody that knows the Pentateuch, you're talking about 10. Well, actually, yeah, 10. Okay. Now, as a result of this history, Jews, okay, they considered Samaritans, they really had an issue with Samaritans. Okay, let's put it blank here, getting straight to the point. They had an issue with Samaritans. They really considered them to be heretical. Okay, so there was a lot of cultural tension going on. So that's the reason why I wanted to explain that to you so you understood. Okay. But notice something very important in these next couple of verses. Because it mentioned in verses 5 and 6, he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now, it says Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat there by the well. It was about the sixth hour. Okay, the sixth hour, right? So this was a location, again, of Jacob's well, which has been set by a firm tradition among Jews. Okay. Now understand something. Samaritans, Muslims, Christians, you know, today in this, they specifically notate this. Okay. This particular well. All right. And so it says that Jesus was wearied from his journey. All right. Wearied. So since the word became flesh, right, he also suffered from physical limitations in his humanity. Okay. So he did experience that. Right. And notice in verse 7, it said a woman of Samaria came to draw water. And so he asked the woman to give him something to drink. He did ask. Now, women generally came in groups to collect water. That's one thing that was distinctive about this. You know, they either came earlier or later in the day to avoid the sun's heat. Now, if the Samaritan woman alone came around noon, you know, this may indicate that her public shame caused her to be isolated from other women. But notice, though, of course, Jesus asked her for something to drink. Now, for a Jewish man to speak to a woman in public, let alone ask her, a Samaritan, for a drink, was really a breach of social custom, as well as really a marked departure, okay, from the social animosity that really existed between the two groups of people. Right. So, of course, in verse 8, we see it says, for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. So that's the reason why, of course, he wasn't given water. He didn't have the means at the time because the disciples had departed. Okay. So he needed and he wanted something to drink. And so that's the reason why he was asking at that particular time. Right. And so she questions and asks, you know, how are you asking me for a drink? I'm a Samaritan woman. And she says in verse 9, for Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. And she put it out there. But Jesus answered and said to her, look, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Notice living water. Living water is, you know, it's common. It's really common, of course, in the word. I know in the Old Testament, you know, the background for this particular term is really important and significant, okay, in a sense of, you know, in the word of God, especially in the prophets, okay, it speaks of how the disobedient Jews, you know, they really rejected him who was the fountain of living water, okay, living water. And so John applies even these themes here, you know, this concept of Jesus being living water to this situation. Okay, so he applies these things to Jesus Christ being the living water, symbolic of eternal life. Okay, eternal life mediated by the Holy Spirit from him. You see, Jesus used the woman's need for physical water to really sustain life in this and region in order to really serve as an object lesson for her need for spiritual transformation. Okay. So that's really what's going on, and which is really good because, you know, he really gets straight to the point too with this woman. So notice what happens with the dialogue as well. Okay. Notice what happens because, of course, the woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with. So she starts to ask questions and wondering how all of this is going to be. Okay. But Jesus answers her in verse 13, whoever drinks of this water, you're going to be thirsty again. And then in 14, he says, whoever drinks of the water that I should give him will never thirst. At that point, she was starting to, you know, trying to pay more attention to what Jesus is saying. He says in verse 14, but the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into life, everlasting life. Okay. Powerful, powerful stuff that he's saying here. And look in verse 15. The woman said to him, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw. Okay, nor come here to draw. So the woman did not realize that Jesus was talking about her spiritual needs. That's what's going on, her spiritual needs. So instead, in her mind, she wanted such water in order to avoid her frequent trips to Jacob's well. That's what she was trying to do. But Jesus was getting to the heart of the matter. Okay, he was getting to the heart. So she was like, okay, give me this water so I don't have to come here and draw. And then he says in verse 16, he says, Jesus said to her, go, call your husband and come here. Whoa. So since the woman failed to understand the nature of the living water he offered, you see, Jesus abruptly, he changed the subject quick. You see that? He abruptly turned the dialogue to focus sharply on her spiritual need for conversion and really cleansing from sin. You see, his intimate knowledge of her morally, you know, her morally depraved life, not only really indicated his supernatural ability, but also it focused on her spiritual condition. Okay, her spiritual condition. And here's the amazing thing. That's the amazing thing about God. You know how sometimes we think that we have a need of certain things, especially for those who may not have a relationship with God. You have a need for certain things. It's really not about that. It's about filling that void. It's about having that intimate relationship with God. Sometimes we want to fill that space with things, and it's only really, you know, a more closer relationship with God that we're really in need of. Okay, we need, you know, more of a fresher infilling of the Holy Spirit, or, you know, just drawing closer to him, more and more of God in our lives. Okay, and look at this in verse 18. Because he said, one thing Jesus said was like, yeah, you have said it well. You don't have a husband, for you've had five husbands. And the one whom you have now, he's not your husband, in that you spoke truly. That's verse 18. So she was living conjugally with a man whom Jesus said was not her husband. Okay? You see, with this statement here, you see, our Lord rejected the notion that when two people live together, it constitutes marriage. That's far from the truth. And some people believe that today. As long as you're living together, you husband, no, you're not husband and wife. just because you live together. See, biblically, marriage is always restricted to a public, formal, official, recognized covenant. It's a recognized covenant. All right? Look at verse 19. The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." Okay? See, her knowledge of her life, his knowledge of her life indicated that he had supernatural inspiration. So she became aware of that. And then verse 20, it says, "Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, and you Jews say that in Jerusalem is the place where one ought to worship." See, both Jews and Samaritans recognized that God had commanded their forefathers to identify a specific place for worshiping him. The Jews, recognizing the entire Hebrew canon, chose Jerusalem. The Samaritans noted that the first place Abraham built an altar to God was at Shechem. Okay? Shechem. So it's a totally different place, right? A totally, totally different place. But notice something powerful, even, you know, based on what was shared. Jesus replies, and he says in verse 21, okay, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem worship the Father." Okay? So what he's saying is this. There was no reason to debate locations. Okay? It's not about that. There's no need to even go into that, he's saying. Look at verse 22. He says, "You worship what you do not know. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews." So in other words, he's, you know, confirmed. He says the Samaritans did not know God. They did not have the full revelation of him, and they could not worship him in truth. The Jews did have the full revelation of God in the New Testament. So they knew that they knew the God they worshiped because salvation's truth came first to them. Okay? That's what salvation came to. They came to them first. Look at verse 23. It says, "But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such to worship him." So this is referring to Jesus' death when it says the hour. His death, his resurrection, and his ascension back to the Father. This completed redemption, by the way. And when he speaks of true worshipers, okay, will worship the Father in spirit and truth. True worshipers. See, Jesus's point is that in light of his coming as Messiah and Savior, in light of that, worshipers will be identified, okay? Not by a specific shrine or location, but by their worship of the Father through the Son. Okay? With Christ coming, you know, previous distinctions between true and false worshipers based on locations really disappeared. True worshipers are all those everywhere who worship God through the Son from the heart. It's all about heart worship. It's not about a location. It's not about going to a specific area or a shrine or a city. It's about worshiping God from the heart, from the heart. And then look at verse 24. "God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." You see, this verse represents the classic statement really on the nature of God as spirit. Okay? The phrase means that God is invisible as opposed to the physical, you know, nature of a man. You see, the word order of this phrase, it really puts an emphasis on spirit here. Notice that? See, man can never comprehend the invisible God unless he revealed himself, right? As he did in scripture and when he became a person. Now, when it says he must worship him in spirit and truth, Jesus is not speaking of a desirable element in worship, but that which is absolutely necessary. Must worship him. And then when it says in spirit and truth, let's break that part down. In spirit and in truth. You see, the word spirit does not refer to the Holy Spirit, but to the human spirit. You see, Jesus' point here is that a person must worship not simply by external conformity to religious rituals. It's not about rituals or it's not about places, you know, but it's inward. In spirit, okay, with the proper heart attitude. You got to have the right heart attitude when you're worshiping God. So the reference to truth refers to worship of God consistent with the revealed scripture. That's what this is all about. The worshiping of God consistent with revealed scripture and centered on the Word made flesh, okay, who ultimately revealed his Father, right? That's what the focus is here upon, right? And then, of course, 25, the woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming, right? And when he comes, he will tell us all things. And that's what the Samaritans did. They anticipated the Messiah's coming. They really did. And here is the grand verse of them all. In verse 26, where Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Powerful. So Jesus forthrightly, he declared himself to be Messiah right there. Though his habit was to really avoid such declarations like that to his own Jewish people who had such, political views regarding the Messiah. Okay. So this claim constitutes the main point of the story regarding the Samaritan woman, that he's the Messiah and he has arrived, right? He reveals himself to her, a Samaritan woman, Okay, because she was open, ready to receive the truth. Unfortunately, you know, the Jews, the people whom he was coming to reveal himself to, they rejected him. They rejected him. And so it's all about the point that I'm getting out of this, these verses we've read, understanding this, okay, is that, you know, sometimes we have a divine appointment, you know, a divine appointment where we meet God and we begin our relationship with God. You know, and God will get to the heart of the matter. Sometimes we go to God and our initial beginning of a relationship was for a whole totally different reason. But God goes to the heart of the matter. Okay. He doesn't go dancing around the tree or dancing around the main issue. He goes straight to the issue. Right. So that he can help you to become the woman or the man that he's called you to be. And so understand something. That's what he's all about. He's into changing lives. He's into enhancing lives. And that's what he did for this woman. He doesn't follow the customs and things of that nature in the sense that if that's not the main reason, the main thing that needs to be addressed. Now, he's not going to break law. And he's not going to cause havoc. But he's going to do what spiritually is necessary first. Okay? And then he'll make sure customs is, you know, applied and kept and things like that. Because he doesn't put customs and he doesn't put rituals and religion over the spiritual matters that matter the most. And that's what we have to be cautious of. We have to be cautious of becoming too religious and too, you know, not understanding and being in tune with the Spirit. We as leaders, we have to be in tune with the Spirit. That's why we must continue to pray. Okay, because we want to be able to hear clearly from God as to what he's directing us to do. Sometimes we can be so bogged down and focused in on natural things, right? That we can't get in tune with the spiritual matter, what's going on spiritually that we need to be aware of, especially in the day and age that we're living in today. It's important that we remain prayerful. Okay, but because while many of us may be focused in on the natural matters as far as what's going on, whether it be, you know, in a person's, you know, life specifically or just in the world today, there's something greater happening spiritually that you need to be aware of, right? And the only way that you're going to get a greater understanding of that is when you pray. You got to have some more prayer time with God, and you got to be able to, you know, read more as he leads you. As he leads you to reading scripture, you know, then you begin to open up this word and begin to study it, okay? So hopefully you all have really embraced the content of this chapter is really, really good when it comes to understanding the nature of God, but then also him revealing how we ought to live this life as believers and the type of worship that we ought to have as leaders. It's all about heart worship. It's not about place. It's not about how, you know, religion and how you do it, doing it a certain way. It's about worshiping him for who he is. Okay. Worshiping him for who he is, true worship. All right. So again, I just want to say thank you, everyone, for participating in the virtual Bible study. And at this particular time, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray so that we can be dismissed. So let us pray. So Father in heaven, Lord, we say thank you for this day. Thank you for the time. Thank you for the word, this word about understanding more about the nature of God and how we ought to worship you, being in spirit and in truth. God, may we continue to worship you with the transparency, with all that's in us, God. Not out of form or show or trying to impress other people, but may we worship you truly in spirit and in truth. And so, God, we thank you for this time that you've given us. We just pray that you will bless us and bless our families. We continue to ask for your covering over us as we go forward and as we go throughout this day. May you bring a peace into the minds and the hearts of all people, of those who place their trust in you, a peace that passes all understanding, that it would guard the hearts and minds of your people. And I just pray, Father, that we would cast our cares upon you, for you care for us. May this word be brought to our remembrance throughout the course of this day. And may we have the boldness to share this with other people as well. And so, God, we thank you for this time. And we just continue to ask that your will be done. And so, God, we thank you and we love you. It's in Jesus' name that we ask these things. Amen, amen, and amen. So, everyone, thank you so very much once again for being here for the virtual Bible study. I'm your teacher, Lakeisha McKnight. Be sure to come back here tomorrow morning, 8:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. As I mentioned before, we will soon begin another, or I should say a second part to the Bible study. And it's really been laid on my heart that we learn more about evangelism, how to reach more people, how to bring inspiration, how to bring hope to people who are looking for hope, looking for a relationship with God. And remember, it's not about that they're looking for religion. They're looking for the kingdom because they lost it. Ever since the Garden of Eden, right? The kingdom had been lost. And so for most people, it needs to be restored. They need to find a way, the way back into the kingdom of God. All right, everybody. So thank you so much. And remember, as I always share, and it's so true, I love each and every one of you. And God loves you all the more. Be blessed and have an amazing, amazing Tuesday.